Copying is one of those file operations made trivial by graphical file managers. We copy, paste, drag and drop stuff every day, and all is good, mostly. I invite you behind the scenes where we're going to use the CP command in the terminal to deal with some more advanced use cases. We're going to copy stuff around until there's no space left, and we're going to do it in style. Welcome to Nixtrix. I am Nick, and this is CP. How's it going, guys? Welcome back to all of us, myself included. In this video, we're going to talk about CP, which is short for copy and is another essential command that we use to, well, copy stuff from one place to another, one or more files or entire directory structures all at once. Oh, and since I've never met a single person who straight up knows how to display progress for a large file operation, I'm just going to show you a few different ways to do it at the end, so stick around. The command has a simple syntax. It's CP followed by options, the source, and then the target or destination. The options can come before or after, it doesn't really matter, but their order does, of course. For the source and destination, we have a few different scenarios, so let's start off with some examples. I've created a demo text file in my local directory, and first I'm going to make a simple copy. That's CP file.txt as the source, and my target's going to be a file named copy.txt. My source was one single file, and since we can't have multiple files with the same name within the same directory, I gave it a different name. In this case, copy.txt did not exist before, it just got created, but if it had, it would have been overwritten by the copy command. Let me show you what happens when the target is a directory. I'm making a new one named copies and cp file.txt copies. Since my target was a directory, the copy command kept the name of my source file when it created file.txt under copies. Similarly, from inside the copies directory, I can copy the other file here and use dot as my target to reference the current directory. Note that the option to rename the file still exists. All I have to do is to specify the name that I want within the path that represents my target. I'm copying again to /another.txt. And now I have three files with the same content. Alright, I'm gonna clean up this directory and go back up to show you how we can copy multiple files at once. It's actually quite straightforward. CP accepts multiple arguments as the source, so as long as the last argument is the directory, the command will interpret it as the target and copy all the files to it. The same can be achieved with a more verbose syntax using the T flag. This allows us to specify the target first and make our intentions clear early on. In this example, I'm using multiple source arguments again, but they're at the end. It's a temp file and a glob that targets all the text files. Ah, yes, globs. Powerful stuff, really. You could get quite creative with them. If you want to know more about this type of expansion, I do have a recent video on the topic that you absolutely have to check out if you haven't seen it already. Alright, now we've seen how to copy files, but when it comes to copying directories, CP is not going to do it by default. It's going to copy everything else that is not a directory in the case of multiple sources and issue a message to let you know. Copying a directory would be a recursive operation, and the command expects you to use the R flag to allow it. While copying certainly sounds like a safe thing to do, we must still consider the potential dangers of data loss in scenarios such as handling the overwrite logic when the destination already exists. Luckily, CP provides plenty of options just for that, and we're going to explore them all, and I'm clearing everything up so we can start with some fresh examples, and the first option that we're going to talk about is I for interactive. This is a popular flag you might already be familiar with from other commands. It enables interactive mode, which basically asks you if you want to overwrite files in case they already exist. You would see this message, and if you wish to overwrite the target, you would type Y and then press Enter. Some people actually prefer to play it safe and have this as the default behavior of the command. I've noticed this common practice of having aliases that override the original command, so in this case the I flag would become implicit. You can check out my video on aliases for other cool examples and a full guide on how to use them. Next up we have the force flag, that's -f, and we can use it to force overwrite files, you know, just in case it cannot do it on its own, as it normally would. I can change these permissions here to demonstrate such a scenario. No video on permissions yet, but I do plan on covering chmod and chown and throwing in a complimentary video on ACLs later this year. Know that the force flag is ignored if -n is also used. which takes us to -N or no clobber, which can be used to prevent all overwriting. So if the destination already exists, it'll remain untouched. Using this option overwrites the I flag, as in it renders the interactive mode useless. One of the most useful flags is U for update, which can be used to perform overwrites only if the source file is newer than the target. If the target doesn't exist, it'll of course get created as expected. Next, we have an option for backups, that's -B, and we can use this to keep both files instead of overwriting anything, and this will add a suffix to the existing file. The default suffix is a tilde character, and you might have actually already seen this suffix around on temporary or buffer files. We could also have a custom suffix using the capital S option like this, or the long option --suffix equals something. And this concludes the list of options for handling overwrites. Now we have a few options left for creating links instead of copies and for handling existing links when copying. The man page says we can use the S flag, that's lowercase s, to create soft links or symbolic links instead of copies, but we should be aware of some limitations. These are relative symbolic links, so the destination directory has to be the current directory, and even then, it only works on the first directory level in a recursive mode. On the other hand, we can use the lowercase l flag in a similar way to create hard links instead of copies. This is more forgiving when it comes to the destination, but not completely. Let's remember that hard links have to sit on the same file system since they're all about inodes, so you cannot create such copies across different drives, for instance. If you're not sure how soft links are different from hard links and why that's important, or if you just need a quick refresher on the topic, I also have a video on the ln command that you can check right after this. I made quite a few references in this video, and you'll find all the links in the description besides all these small pop-ups at the top. Alright, the next two flags allow us to change the behavior of CP when it encounters symlinks in the source. So, it could either follow the link and copy the actual content that it points to instead, or copy the symlink as it is, regardless of whether or not it breaks. The long options are dereference and no dereference, but I find it easier to remember the short flags. Those are capital L as in link, will follow links and copy the content that they point to, and capital P will preserve the links as they are even if they appear broken on their new destination. One last option that can be very handy is -A for archive, which is basically the equivalent of the recursive flag and the long option preserve all, but I always remember it as the all flag because it copies both files and directories alike and keeps all the ACLs intact. You can get more selective with the --preserve option. This section in the manual describes all the supported attributes. The defaults are mode, ownership, and timestamps. That's the equivalent of the short flag -p. But there's also security context, links, extended attributes, or all of the above. Now, one of the things that becomes painfully obvious when copying large amounts of data is the lack of visual feedback. Of course, we can use the V flag for verbose mode, which can help when copying multiple files, but even then, it can still feel like you're flying blind if the files are large in size. If you're looking for some form of real-time progress monitor, CP is not going to give you that. Except on BSD-ish environments like macOS, where pressing Ctrl+T in a terminal will send a SIG info signal to the process and return some information. One quick and dirty way to get some clue of what's happening is to query the destination for file size or file count using a watcher. Not as cool as a progress bar, and you do have to know what to expect from the output, but it works, it's handy, and I'm not the only one who does that. Another way would be to pipe the copy command to an external tool, but there are limitations and it can really get overly complicated. I've used PV and progress before I've tried bar. And they're all great, but not so much when copying directories. I've also tried GCP, that's a little tool written in Python, but it has its own small issues, and it shares the same name with the Git cherry-pick alias in Z-shell. Well, all of this leaves us with one in-house solution that I consider to be the cleanest option. If you were thinking of rsync, think again. Nah, it is rsync. rsync is a super versatile tool for copying files kind of an overkill in this case, but if all you need to do is copy some stuff around and monitor the progress of it, it's really easy to just slap in a flag for progress and Marvel add its output, as it does almost the same thing as CP. As some of you guys suggested before in the comments, a video on rsync is already in the works, but next week, however, we're looking at the mv command, which should feel quite familiar now that we've seen how copying works. We're going over moving and renaming files, some tricks to do it in batches, and after that, we're going to be diving into rsync, so stay tuned. There are links in the description and some really great buttons right above it if you want to show your support for this type of content and want to see more of it. A huge shout out to all of you folks who have joined our community, and if you're new here, consider subscribing and hitting that bell so you can stay in the loop and never miss one of these. Thank you so much for watching, have a great day, and I'll see you in the next one.